expertise, and great product selection in paint, hardware, lawn and garden. That's Rockies, rock solid service since 1926. On the web at Rockies.com.
Saturdays were made for polka. Tune in to the Polka Jammer Network starting at 6 a.m. and Polka Hall of Famer Billy Bolina breakfast at BB at 8:30.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
A girl went back to Napoli because she missed the scenery, the native dances and the charming songs. But wait a minute, something's wrong. Hey mambo, mambo Italiano. Hey mambo, mambo Italiano. Go, go, go. You mixed up Siciliano. All you Calabrese do the mambo like a crazy with a hey mambo. Don't want a tarantella. Hey mambo. No more mozzarella, hey mambo, mambo Italiano. Try an enchilada with the fish baccalà. Hey gumba, I love how you dance a rumba. But take some of advice, paisano, learn how to mambo. If you're gonna be a square, you ain't gonna go nowhere. Hey mambo, mambo Italiano, hey mambo, mambo Italiano. Go, go, Joe. Shake it like a Giovanni. Hey, look, as a ditch, you get a happy in the feet. So when you mambo Italiano. Shake a baby, shake it, cause I love her when you take a me. Say stop or I'm gonna tell a papa and a hey, rule. You don't have to go to school. Just make a weed a beat a bambino. It's like a vino. Kid, you're good at looking, but you don't know what's cooking till you hey mambo, mambo Italiano. Hey mambo, mambo Italiano. Oh, oh, oh. You mixed up Siciliana. It's so delicious. Everybody come capisce how to mambo Italiano. That's nice.
Ooh, good morning, everybody. Ciao.
It's your song. You should know when it ends.
I love it. I was thinking in my head about what I was going to say. Good morning. Welcome to the Joe Show, first Wednesday of the month. We're here with my co-host, Mommy Carol Palmer.
Hi.
Pete's lighting it up in there. We got a lot to talk about all over the place again. I keep trying to think every time, you know, the few days before when I start, because, you know, we have some items on the agenda that are kind of timely, you know, you got to wait. Well, you know, you want to wait, and if you're going to talk about sports, you don't want to talk about sports from 4 days ago or something. So, but anyway, I was trying to, you know, there's no structure. It's just, this is a good thing there's an outline, because at least it keeps us on track.
Well, that's
because otherwise,
it's the only thing that keeps you on track. Let's be honest.
And I'm still going to go off track. I know it. I know I will. But okay, that's fine. So I just wanted to first, we'll start now on the heels of that great song by Rosemary Clooney, which I love. I wish I knew how to dance. I would dance to that every time.
You know
time.
How to dance.
Yeah, like a nerd.
You don't want to. Like, kind of like your father.
Yeah. bite the lower lip there and shuffle back and forth with your thumbs in the air.
What's wrong with that?
Nothing, I guess. That's fine. It's the dad dance. I am a dad, after all. So, we started this last month, the Italian word of the day.
Yeah.
And I thought it was interesting how to then match that up with what people would start to learn the Italian-American language since we are in America. And, you know, well, we're both Italian, so we can throw this out there, see what happens. All right. So the Italian word of the day is fiori.
Fiori.
I knew a fiori.
Yeah,
Mario.
Mario Fiori?
Yeah. Well, no, that's an Italian name.
Yeah, he was the head of the 44 modified race team.
Oh.
And that would be Mario Fiori.
Si.
And you know what it means?
I do. Do you?
Yeah.
What?
Flower.
Correct.
Okay. And on to the Italian-American word of the day. Churri.
That I don't know.
It means flower.
Same thing?
Yeah.
That's not an Italian word.
It's the Italian-American word for flower is churri.
Never heard that before.
Well, I'm just saying, this is why it's interesting.
I'm more Italian than you, and I never heard it before.
Well, maybe I'm more Italian-American than you.
That's possible.
Maybe you're Italian-Italian.
I'm purebred.
Right?
Yep.
Well, it's just like last month when we did the word, and it was Chipola. Remember?
Mm-hmm.
Which you know what that means.
What's it mean?
Remember?
What does it mean? I forget.
Me too. What is it, butter or something like that? I can't remember.
Moving on.
And
do your show prep, please.
She's making me go back a month. I can't go back that far. I can't remember what happened yesterday. I did a lot of prep, Pete. I was up.
If you're doing dedicated segments for the Italian word of the day, you should know what the definition is. Yeah.
Well, the co-host should stay on track, maybe. Let's go backwards. What was that?
You talking to me?
Yeah, I'm talking to you.
All right. Anyway, so there you go. So next on our list is about happy news because we like to keep this positive. We don't want to complain. We don't want to, you know, start reporting out the news like the sensationalistic journalism that goes on every day. It makes me absolutely crazy. Mm-hmm. And when they came out with, here I go now. I was just going to talk about it. No, I'm not going to. About the vice presidential selection.
No, don't even go there.
And we're not going to talk about that. But you know what I thought was
let everybody else rip into shreds first.
Well, that was the thing is, you know, instead of
both
trying
sides.
Yeah, exactly. I know. I had to shut it off. I couldn't listen. I'm like, come on. Although I do want to say one thing about it.
This it was great. Positive. It had a pretty much lack of news for 2 weeks.
Yeah, I know. I know.
I was too busy.
Yeah, you were busy.
I've been watching the Olympics much better.
Oh, yeah. Well, we'll get to that, too. We got good stuff.
Well.
Huh?
Well, the competition's been okay.
Yeah.
Hey, everything's fine with me as long as the women's beach volleyball's on.
Oh, God.
Hello. Hello.
By the way, why is 3-on-3 basketball an Olympic sport?
I don't know. I was wondering that,
even
too.
As a demonstration sport. 3-on-3 basketball? Seriously?
Yeah, no. I don't get it.
Really?
I wonder how long that's been like that.
I think it's the first Olympics. No. I've seen it. I've never seen it before.
Well, what makes me...
they got rid of baseball.
Right.
And softball.
Yeah.
And they've added 3-on-3 basketball?
Well, probably. You know what I bet you it is, Pete? I bet you it's a segue into getting rid of regular basketball. Because there's no competition. No competition. The United States is so much better and always will be.
They'll probably add pickleball.
Oh, God. Okay. No, you got to. Oh, well, anyway. Yes.
Moving on.
Okay, pickleball.
Yay.
Mm-hmm. Want to see something funny?
Yes.
All right. This happened to me while we were setting up for one of our opening ceremonies.
Okay.
Check this out. Watch the left side of your screen. That is an inflatable tunnel that the kids come through with smoke at nighttime.
Okay, yeah.
Watch what happens.
All right.
It's starting.
Uh-oh.
There it goes.
Oh, it's blowing away.
All right. Oh, there's one kid like, oh, poof. Knock him over.
That's
grab
Augie.
It.
Yeah.
Somebody grab it.
That thing's going to take off.
Now, the funny part is, so they get a handle on it there, right? A little bit, sort of. After it tackles both of them several times. What they said, it was the sandbags whipping around. They were trying to avoid getting whacked by the sandbags.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
If you look out in center field right about now, I think, and we're just in a second, you'll see what actually happened with it because something out there becomes manifested where you can actually see what happened. Look at that. The dust devil.
Oh, yeah.
So it was like a mini tornado, dust devil tornado that picked it up and started whipping it around.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, man, it doesn't spin like that if it's straight line winds. It would just blow it. It would blow it over and across.
Right.
The dust devil, and it persisted all the way into the other baseball pod, but you could still see it spinning out there. So a dust devil actually picked it up and started whipping it around. That's I didn't notice it on the first play, but apparently somebody told me they saw it. Mr. S said he saw it on SportsCenter.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
So they must have grabbed it from our social media or something and put it up there. But
you're famous.
I couldn't find it, but I'm like, well, it's a great feature having a security system also being your, you know, what's feeding your cameras.
Yeah, right.
Because it records it, all of it.
Yep.
But that was poor Augie's trying to catch the thing so it doesn't blow away.
That would be my luck.
They're running around in circles because it's spinning it.
I like the guy that was at home plate who seemed real concerned. He starts shuffling out.
One of the other rec assistants, Zach.
Hey, get that thing. Hey, while I walk really slow to help you.
Zach's like, I'm not going to get wiped out by that thing.
No, I'd let it go. Not mine. Oh, God. That's funny. It's like
a little slapstick to you know, change your morning a little bit.
Well, it's like one of those Ring doorbell videos that you see.
Yeah.
Right? Where,
absolutely.
You know, it's intended to be a security thing, but every once in a while, you know, some old people come out and slip on the ice and take each other down. And then they lay there and go, oh.
I saw that happen to Steve Nagel. He caught himself on his own camera.
Great.
And posted it when he took a canner out in front of his house last year.
Quit saying old people.
That can happen to anybody.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So, one happy news thing, and that's it, really, because we got other stuff to talk about. And, it's really hard to find, actually, when you go on and you say, I want to read about happy things and good things and inspiring things. Good luck. Did you know that the U.S. Post Office is doing a tribute to Alex Trebek by making stamps that look like a Jeopardy question?
Oh, yes. I heard that. Yes.
Isn't that cool?
That is cool.
But the question on it, they're all the same, I guess, is it says something like, this man hosted the Jeopardy from blah, blah, blah to blah, blah, blah. And, you know, what
does it give the answer, though?
Well, it's Alex Trebek.
Well, I know, but I mean, on the stamp, when it asks the question, then how do you know the answer?
Does it give the answer to the question?
I don't know. Why would they give? No, they don't. No, it looks like the question. They don't give the answer with the question. Everybody knows it's Trebek.
But yeah, but there's other questions, right?
Well, he's pictured in the stamp.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
No, he's not. It looks exactly like what looks on the screen when they have
That's
the Jeopardy question come up.
Yeah.
Hold on.
And I think all the words on every stamp is the same thing.
Oh, okay.
It all says, you know, this man hosted Jeopardy.
All right. I thought you meant they were going to have various questions on the stamp.
No, not that I saw. They looked all the same to me.
Okay. That's
because
cool.
It's a tribute to Alex.
Yes, Trebek. And should be.
Yes. That was very nice.
Although I like Ken. The guy who's the host now.
Yeah, yeah.
Great.
I'd rather see him play, quite honestly. See, there it is.
Something.
That's it.
Let's zoom in on it and see what we got.
Look
here.
At all the questions on there.
No other. Oh, Mamma Mia.
I mean, all the answers.
No. Yeah, the answers.
Let's take a look.
See? Are they all the same?
They look all the same, yeah.
Yeah, it just says it describes him. So.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. So, anyway. I thought that was kind of random, though. It's like, why would the post office all of a sudden just decide Alex Trebek out of all people, maybe? And plus, he's not even American.
Oh, Canadian?
No. No, he was an American citizen.
He is?
I think he became an American citizen.
All right. Okay. He used to love to talk about Canada and all his Canadian stuff.
Blame Canada.
So, you know, I just thought of this morning. In my whole life, no time goes faster for me.
Oh, here we go.
There it is.
The text reads, this naturalized U.S. citizen hosted the quiz show Jeopardy for 37 seasons. Underneath, upside down, is the correct response. Who is Alex Trebek? Next to the words, forever USA.
Nice.
Okay, so there is the answer.
Yeah, upside down.
See?
No, the question.
And the answer, too.
Yeah, both.
But the answer is the question.
Yeah.
Okay, moving on.
I just figured we might as well get it right if we're going to put it out there.
Yeah, I had it right. She was just trying to confuse me. How do you do that? All right. Who is this day in history? Oh, no, wait. That's not the right thing. Hey, you know what today is? National Lighthouse Day.
Oh.
I'm fascinated with lighthouses. Mm. Love them. But I thought to myself this morning, oldest lighthouse in the world. It's got to be unbelievably old if you think about it. So I looked at it, and depending on what you read, there's two different variations, but one of them is the Pharos of Alexandria in Egypt says to be 280 BC.
Ooh.
Imagine that.
Mm.
It's still there.
Wow.
Yeah.
I thought that's the one that sunk.
No,
I know there's one that sank into the ocean.
I don't know. Well, it could be what I was reading might have been old. And maybe it sank. No, because it would have sunk years ago. I don't know. That was one of them. The one I know for sure that is standing is the Tower of Hercules in Spain. And yeah. They don't have an exact date, time, but it's believed to be 2nd century. So call it 250 AD. That's old.
Mm.
To still be standing. And they're huge. 400 feet tall. You know, mammoth. Now,
still operating, though?
I don't know if they're still operating, if they need to still operate, but they're certainly a historic thing. In our country, we have the Boston Light, which is on Little Brewster Island in Boston.
Mm-hmm.
That was 1716 when it was built, renovated in 1783, which is exactly the way it still is now. And that one's a small one when you compare it to a 400-foot.
It is small. I've seen it.
Lighthouse, yeah, it's pretty small. It's like, yeah. I don't know, 50, 60 feet tall or something, whatever. But there you go. That's the National Lighthouse Day information. The other thing I wanted to talk about, I got two phones going now.
I see that.
Yeah, I got to cut the cord with the iPhone and go with the Android. Because this is the one that actually works now as a phone.
Okay.
The other one's just like a tablet. It might as well be the old iPhone. But I still use it because I can't get used to the new one yet. All right. It's really hard to put glasses on when you have headphones on. You know that? All right. Here's one that.
By the way, before you move on to that.
Yeah.
This is what it actually looks like. I found a blown up one.
Oh, there you go.
So the answer's written like somebody wrote the answer in.
Yeah. Okay, I gotcha.
Yeah.
That makes more sense.
Yeah.
Nice. Okay. So those are forever stamps too then, so I'm going to buy a ton of those.
Yeah, buy it now because they keep going up on the price.
Yeah, exactly. I don't use stamps that often, you?
Oh, yes, I send cards to all the kids every birthday, Christmas, etc.
Do, yeah.
Anniversaries. Yeah, I use a lot of stamps.
Nah,
cards, mostly cards. I don't send letters anymore.
I bet you maybe once a month I'll use a stamp.
Hmm.
Huh.
Well, buy them for me.
Okay. Here's your present for Christmas.
Thank you.
So, we were talking about National Lighthouse. There's another thing. This day in history, by the way, boring. Boring.
Really?
Hell.
It's National Purple Heart Day.
Yeah, I was just going to say that.
It is National Purple Heart Day. That's true. Who did that? Carter?
Tina did that.
Who?
What?
Well, Tina covered on your show. I don't know who made it.
The president. I think it was Carter.
Well, he made it for all branches of service.
Yes. Okay. Gotcha. In 2007, Barry Bonds broke Hank Aaron's home run record of 755.
Oh. Snooze.
Widely disputed record.
Snooze.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I as a life.
Don't make me get out Homer Simpson.
I know. Lifelong baseball fan, love it. You know, Mom, it's my favorite thing. When I was a kid, it's my whole life. And I still can't figure out how I feel about that whole banned substance, steroid era.
I know.
You know, those guys. Would they really have been that good? No. But I just hate to, again, it's.
But it was also looked the other way.
Correct. Right. yeah, you can't, I won't say condone, but you can't turn a blind eye to something forever and then turn around and say, hey, kind of like the next story that I have. That segues perfectly, Pete. This day in history, French-born Philippe Petit. Now, first of all, I want to know what French-born means. What does that
born
mean?
Born in France.
Yeah. So I'm U.S.-born. Why do you have to say that? Can't you just say Frenchman Philippe, probably? No.
No.
Philippe Petit.
Petit, which means
French
small.
Guy. No, okay.
Petit means
he walked on a high wire between the newly built Twin Towers of the World Trade Center, about 1,350 feet above the ground. He was arrested, but the charges were later dismissed.
Because he was petite.
Petite. You know, because he was French-born. They couldn't arrest him because he wasn't American.
Oh, you can arrest him.
Yeah, they can. But here's
you
the
probably
thing.
Should have said you should have cleared the stunt with somebody before you did it.
Exactamundo. Now, why in the world wouldn't somebody say something when they saw a wire between the Twin Towers that nobody authorized anybody to do anything?
They probably did it really quick.
Well, how? What do you got, a guy hanging out the window going, hey, I tied a brick onto the other end, catch. You know, how do you do that?
How do you coordinate anything?
I don't coordinate a lot anymore. But it just blows my mind that this whole thing happened. You know, nobody went, hey, take that stupid wire down. You're not allowed to put wires between buildings over here. Mm-mm, it happened. And then they arrested him.
Well, let him complete the stunt to see if he, makes it.
Yeah, maybe they wouldn't have had to arrest him if he just fell. Serves you right.
If he fell from there, no one would have to do anything. 1,300
feet. I always thought the tightrope walkers with their poles, how they used to balance, they should have had hooks on the end of them. So that way, if they go to fall, they could, hook the rope or the wire and hang there until somebody decides to save them. No.
No.
Nope. That wouldn't be as death-defying.
If you're going to go, you're going to go.
You're going to go famous. And so there you go, Philippe Petit. Good job. I don't know how you got away with it. I'm still trying to figure out how you got a wire between the Twin Towers without anybody saying anything or noticing even. It was probably outside some guy's office window, right? Wasn't he going to be like, hey, could somebody get maintenance and ask them what the hell is going on with this wire?
I would.
I would, too. They should have squashed it before the petite even got the chance. Anyway. All right. There we go. Look at it. It's already 8:30. I told you.
Well.
Who needs a what?
Go on.
No, it's your turn now.
Is it?
Everybody's favorite. Word and Phrase Origins by Noni Palmer.
Okay. So I found some good ones today. Or yesterday. A few you will definitely appreciate. when, for example, newspaper reporting, they're always saying, I have to meet my deadline.
Right.
I have to meet my deadline.
Yeah.
Well, during the Civil War time, that expression came to be because the deadline was the line that they drew in the prison camps. And if a prisoner crossed that line, they would be immediately shot. So that's the deadline. And that's where that expression came from.
What if you're on it?
You can't be on it. You can be either before it or after it.
Yeah, because your foot's going to hang over. Anyway.
But what if you meet the deadline?
Then you stay alive.
Okay.
Pulling my leg.
Oh, yeah.
It happened in London. It started in London because a popular tactic among robbers and thieves is to drag people down by grabbing their legs and pull legs out from under them before stealing their stuff. So pulling my leg originated with thieves because that's how they used to rob people.
Really?
Still not a bad idea if you think about it.
Oh.
Here's one. For our beloved person in the booth. For Pete's sake. Do you know where that came from, Pete?
No.
Somewhere around 1903, because the expression before that would say, oh, for God's sake, oh, for Jesus' sake, whatever. Well, they decided that was a little sacrilegious, whoever these people were. And they said, well, St. Peter, right, was the secondhand guy. So instead of saying for God's sake, we're going to say for Pete's sake. So it came from substituting St. Peter for the word God or Jesus.
So that way it's not blasphemy.
Correct.
Nice. Thanks, Pete.
Sure.
How about paying through the nose?
Does that have something
paying
to do
through
with
the nose?
Cocaine?
No.
Oh.
Started back with ancient days, the Danish Vikings. If someone didn't pay their taxes, they would slit the nose from the tip to the eyebrow.
Oh.
And that's called paying through the nose.
So then you don't have to pay after that?
Apparently not.
you get on. Wow, that's a little harsh.
Yeah, that is a little harsh. Although some of the in the Islamic fundamentalist countries, the punishment for the crimes are pretty harsh like that.
Right.
Yes. How about baker's dozen?
That's a 13.
What happened? Right. So when you order rolls, baker's dozen, they give you the 13th one, right? Because, again, I don't know what's with these British people, but back in the 13th century, you would go to a baker for your bread or your rolls or your whatever, and pastries. And if the baker was caught shorting a customer specifically, or even selling low quality bread, they could have their hands cut off. And so it was easier just to throw in an extra roll to make sure that the people got a dozen.
So that you didn't miscount somehow.
You didn't miscount and have your hands cut off.
Nowadays, the state had to pass a law to have people do that. Do you know that? A lot of people, with the electronic registers, they just scan stuff through and you never look at your thing. So if it's programmed wrong and it's displayed as something different on the shelf, that the state had to pass a law saying that you would have some recourse as a consumer to say that's wrong and get it for the price on the shelf.
And then they cut the guy's hands off?
Well, I mean, no. That's not as harsh, but
only in Britain.
Think about that. They had to reinstate that because people aren't honest.
Right, right.
And here, and the last one I have is a pretty logical one. And you've heard people say, I wash my hands of that situation, right?
Yep.
I wash my hands. And that actually came from, of course, Pontius Pilate, who condemned Jesus to death. But once that everybody was in agreement that should happen, what did he do? He washed his hands and he said, I wash my hands of this whole situation.
This whole matter.
I wash my hands of your inhibitions.
So there you go.
What?
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 That was a song from the Jesus Christ Superstar.
Oh, yes.
Pontius Pilate, I wash my hands of your inhibitions.
Situation.
Inhibitions, I think he says.
No.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Generation.
That's where that all came from. So.
Nice.
Yeah.
You know which one I want to know? Just write this down for next time. Here. Use my look, kids. It's a number 2 yellow pencil with an eraser.
Yeah.
Come hell or high water.
Come hell. Oh, you know that's got to have a good.
Yeah. I said that out loud this morning. I said, come hell or high water, I got to be out of this house at 7:45.
Uh-huh.
That's true. Nice. Thank you. Uh-huh. That's good. I love those ones. We got to keep the. You wanted to get rid of that once, but we keep it.
Okay.
All right. And now, you know what? Let's do. I want to do the sports and the movie review and the joke after the. Let's take a break, but.
Better hurry up.
Do you have the song there, Pete?
Yeah.
I just want to say this before we play that song. This song is in honor of my friend John Sam, who just passed away recently.
R.I.P., John.
Yeah. Here we go.
And And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, oh no, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man, what has he got, if not himself, then he has not to say.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield.
Join me, Tina Gorman, each week from 6 to 8 a.m. for Wake Up Wednesday, when my guests and I discuss health, wellness, and lifestyle reimagined.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to the Joe Show, the first Wednesday of the month at 8 a.m. That was Frank, Old Blue Eyes. That song will get stuck in your head, so there
That's
you go.
That's for sure.
Yeah. So now we skipped over a couple things, and there's still a topic that I want to discuss before the end of the show regarding our beloved community radio station. And just a little bit of my thoughts on that, due to some recent events that are all good. Everything's good, but I don't know if people ever talk about the actual radio show or the station and what goes into, you know, being able to put this out and all the work that's involved and, you know, behind the scenes stuff, and Pete takes care of all of that, and it's incredible. So we'll delve into that in a little bit, but I wanted to get to the sports report, which I like to call "Hi Mom." Hi Mom. So we'll talk about the Red Sox real quick. They won last night versus Kansas City.
Two in a row.
And that was, yeah, they already swept the series with them. Kansas City's tough. They are. They're actually good. This is a year where I love this already. Let's go.
Said you're doing sports
live from WSKB.
This is from a show we used to do years ago called the Real Fake Fantasy Sports Show. they're when we used to do predictions, this would be the music bed.
Yeah, you know, in the background.
Yeah,
nice.
A digital pack rat.
The Kansas City is about equal to the Red Sox right now in their record. They have actually last night it was fantastic to see the Red Sox closer, Jansen, actually get out the Royals' best player, who's Bobby Witt Jr.
Yes.
Really good.
Yeah.
And you know, so he got that done. And the Red Sox are sitting at 5.5 games out of first place below the Yankees and the Orioles. And here's bizarro world for me, right? Bizarro world is the Orioles and the Royals are better than the Red Sox. And I know, you know, we still got a ways to go, but just in my days, you had teams that were always the rotten, you know, turds, and it was usually Baltimore, Kansas City, who else in the American League was always a stinker. But, you know, they had their times, of course. They had when they had fantastic players and they won some stuff. They Kansas City had George Brett way back in the day. Orioles had Cal Ripken Jr. and on and on and on. In the 70s, they had a really, really good team. But now...
And then it became about...
Yeah. So now you got the large market teams that's just taken over everything. And
not
and
anymore. Got,
well...
Yankees aren't all that good either.
Well,
no, they are not.
They're not that. No, they shouldn't be in first place, quite honestly, with the team that they have. But they are. And, you know, we got a lot of young guys still, like I said before.
I love them.
And they seem to be blossoming just at the right time.
Yeah.
So fingers crossed, and hopefully they don't get rid of Devers. And we still have our center fielder there. What's
Duran?
His name? Duran.
Yeah.
Jaren.
He's awesome.
Jaren. Jaren?
Jared.
Jared?
Yeah.
Or Jaren?
I thought it was Jared.
Chipola. Onion. That's what it meant. Aha, I got you, Pete. I did my show prep in my brain. Chipola, Italian for onion. Jaboud, Italian-American for onion. There you go. All right, now back to Olympics.
Not back to your really scheduled sports show.
The Olympics, we're doing good. The end. No. The U.S. leads in total medal count and now total gold over China. So I just thought of something the other day. Why is it that the U.S. is so damn good? Why are they leading in total medals by far? Why are they leading in gold medals? Why are they beating countries like China and, you know, England and whatever else you say? So I thought to myself, you know, and this is no, it's a fact. The great melting pot, right? Isn't that what they always used to say? The United States is a great melting pot. Mm-hmm. It's like we're a giant Walmart that has everything. You know, we're the Walmart of the world. We have everything. We have every department. We have food. We have jewelry. We have clothes. We have toys. We have gardening stuff. You need it, we got it. So you need someone for gymnastics? Boom, we got them. Basketball? Boom, we got them. Swimming? Boom, we got them. Discus? We got them. We just, now there's some countries where they don't have that diversity. And or the number of people that could be, you know, built for or physically have the physical prowess to do certain things, right? So I was trying to say, like, you're probably not going to see somebody from China who's, you know, going to be a shot put person.
Well, I think the
that's
other...
not totally true.
Well, it's like,
I think
it depends on population size, right?
That's what I'm... Yeah, it's both.
That's
right.
Why China does so well in the Olympics, because they have a population of 1 billion.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
No kidding.
Yeah.
With a B.
Yeah, I know.
Well, I think, too, we're sports-minded. And fortunate for us, because a lot of third-world countries, for example... They can't be sports-minded.
They don't have the luxury.
They don't have that luxury.
They have to exist.
Right.
So I think we have that, and we promote it in our children when they're very young, which is a good thing. And we're able to have training centers and people who are experts to train these kids, and I think that's how they grow up.
Yeah.
So
that's why communist countries did it so much during the Cold War, and that's why China does it today. Is they have the same problems with the populations you're talking about, yet the government puts a priority on it, and
correct.
So what the government says goes.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
And so they pull kids out of a field and say, you're going to be a gymnast.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Yep.
Right, yeah.
And do everything and you know.
And you better do it.
I mean, there was the joke about the boxers that, you know, whatever, but that used to be the joke about the East German women's team.
Yes. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Or the Russian women's team. They'd look like hairy men.
Right. Yeah.
And you'd be like, well, okay.
Weightlifting and stuff like that, yeah.
Right. And yeah. I was sitting there going, well, there's a whole big controversy about whatever. And I'm like, no, this is the same joke that we dealt with 20, 30 years ago. And it's like, it's probably the same things. This person took testosterone to bulk themselves up.
Yeah.
And you keep taking that through when you're a teenager. If that's what your country decides, you're going to be a boxer and you're going to succeed. Well, they'll do everything to make that happen.
Yeah. Legally or
and
not.
And I'm like, yeah, right, exactly.
Yeah.
Right. They gotta represent.
That was enough of my rattling on that one.
Oh, you're absolutely correct.
I just found it was like the same damn... Does anybody like have any memory, or we just like, oh, it's the latest outrage? No, this is the same thing that happened 30 years ago.
Going on a long time.
I start to notice that with multiple things as I get older. Where I go, come on, you know, history does repeat
this is
itself.
It's not new.
It just
we've been down this road before.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
We laughed at it then, and they right. got away with it. Well, we're laughing at, we're outraged now, but they're still getting away with it.
Right.
Anyways.
You know?
Hurry up.
All right. Oh, yeah.
You don't want to miss my joke.
All right. I got a good Olympics joke. Ready? All right. Let's do, all right. End of music. I gotta concentrate on my joke. This is a good one. I loved this one. I think this is my favorite one so far for the radio. An Englishman, Scotsman, and an Irishman wanted to see the Olympics, but they didn't have tickets. They went round back to see if they could sneak in, but there was a guard at the rear entrance, which is also where the competing athletes entered. The Englishman looks around and sees a long pole on the ground, gets an idea. He grabs the pole, walks up to the guard, and says, Bentley, England, pole vaulting. The guard lets him in, thinks he's an athlete. Scotsman sees this, and he thinks he could try too. He grabbed a manhole cover, walked up to the guard, and said, McGregor, Scotland, discus. And the guard let him in.
With a manhole cover?
Yeah, with discus.
Okay.
You know, maybe he was a big Scotsman. The Irishman's looking all over for something to help get him in, and he sees a bale of barbed wire. He grabs the bale and proudly exclaims to the guard, Murphy, Ireland, fencing.
Fencing.
Yes.
Oh, wait a minute. Give me a copy of that joke. I'll send it to my brother over at Broder Campbell.
Okay. Fencing.
Oh, fencing.
You go ahead. What's your joke?
Oh, okay. But mine doesn't have to do with sports.
Well, we're done with sports.
Okay. So this was posted. I cannot shop at Costco anymore. Yesterday I was at Costco buying a large bag of Purina dog chow for my loyal pet, the wonder dog, Nico, which weighs 191 pounds. I was in the checkout line when a woman behind me asked if I had a dog. What did she think I had? An elephant? So because I'm retired and have little to do, on impulse, I told her that no, I don't have a dog. I was starting the Purina diet again. I added that I probably shouldn't because I ended up in the hospital last time I tried it, but that I'd lost 50 pounds before I awakened in an intensive care unit with tubes coming out of most of my orifices and IVs in both arms. I told her that it was essentially a perfect diet, and that the way that it works is to load your pocket with Purina nuggets and simply eat one or two every time you feel hungry. The food is nutritionally complete, so it works well. And I was going to try it again. I have to mention here that practically everyone in the line was now enthralled with my story. Horrified, she asked if I ended up in intensive care because the dog food poisoned me. I told her, no. I stopped to pee on a fire hydrant and a car hit me. Costco won't let me shop there anymore. Better watch what you ask retired people. They have all the time in the world to think of crazy things to say.
Yeah.
Oh, my. Oh, my.
That's true. Yeah.
I love that story. I'm going to start making up stories in line.
I do it all the time. Yeah. I realize that I exaggerate everything. See, I just did it again.
Yep.
Everything. Everything. All right. One last piece till we get to where I digress. We started a movie review segment.
Yeah.
I'm not going to do a movie review this month because I saw something that just so enthralled me that I wanted to throw it out there. It's the 20-year reunion of The Sopranos.
Oh.
And it's about an hour-long interview with the kind of the top people from the show.
Yeah.
20 years later, of course, sans
Gandolfini.
Gandolfini.
Yeah.
He was the only one that wasn't there from the characters that were big that you'd remember, you know.
Yeah.
Paulie Walnuts is there. What's his name? Stevie Van Zandt.
Oh, yeah.
And, of course, the kids and Edie Falco, the psychiatrist lady, Lauren.
Is this on Netflix?
Actually, you can watch it on YouTube. If you just put in a search for the 20-year Sopranos reunion.
Yeah.
It was fascinating because they were telling all kinds of stories about, well, a lot of it was about James Gandolfini because, you know, it was kind of a tribute sort of thing. He's no longer here. But just the fact that it was very interesting to me that they never thought that this show was going to take off.
They
never thought.
Really?
They thought it was just going to be a flop and nobody was going to care.
Wow.
And because now you got to remember, if you go back 20 years, right, most of the shows that people watched at night anyway were network TV shows.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were watching Seinfeld and, well, I don't know if that was still on, but Everybody Loves Raymond or Three Men and a Baby. I don't know. What was that one with Charlie Sheen? Two and a Half Men.
Two and a Half Men.
You know, they were watching all these. Well, The Sopranos couldn't be on network TV. Too violent and too, explicit. So they were on HBO, and they thought, this is no way. It's not going to work. Even after they saw the pilot, they were still convinced it wasn't going to work. But it did. And so the rest is history. It's one of my favorite shows.
Remember our family thing that we started? We gave points if you guessed the person
right.
who was going to get whacked
right.
that week.
Yeah, yeah. I never knew. Well, anyway, there you go. So now we got 5 minutes. I wanted a half hour to talk about this. We have 5 minutes. That's why we don't need a guest, unless it's somebody good, really good. Anyway, so I was going to ask Pete to kind of come in with his thoughts on this, but what I wanted to say in 5 minutes now, I guess, but...
Yeah, you're almost out of time.
I know. I see how it happened. Is that I actually got a new job that will prompt me to have to reconsider what to do with the Joe Show. And I talked to Pete about it, and we came to a solution. I was afraid that today was going to be the Joe Show finale, but it's not. So thank God for that. And after talking to the producer of the station, he convinced me that we should stick with it, even though I started to be a little bit melancholy and saying, you know, I don't want to be irrelevant. I don't want to take up somebody else's slot. I don't want to just talk gibberish for an hour and have nobody care. You know, all of these things that go through, I'm sure every other person who has a show on this station feels the same way at some point. You know, what are my ratings? You don't know. How many people watch this? You don't know. Quite frankly, now after been doing this for 3 years and over 20 something shows, we had a little bit of a hiatus for a while.
Yep.
But after doing it for this long, you know, you really start to look at it and say, I don't really care how many people watch this. I don't really care. I would love it if
I gave the description of what public access is actually about.
Right.
It's about people doing shows. It doesn't matter if, honestly, you'd like people to watch it, but it doesn't really matter if they watch it.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's getting your opinion, viewpoint of the world out there.
Yeah, and what really hooked me into, you know, not having this be the finale of the Joe Show and going through arrangements so that we can keep this for the first Wednesday of the month at 8 a.m. is that Pete said to me, everybody brings their own perspective to the station. And I thought, you know, maybe I'm not the guy I used to be when this show first started, and I'm not bringing the same information to the table. Maybe, well, I'm not, but it's morphed into something else that I actually really love to do, and I don't get paid. You know, my mother doesn't get paid. And
the same thing happened. I told him about Joe Didi's story.
Right.
Joe Didi came on representing Southwick as a selectman. That's Everything Southwick was the show that he did. He was the only one that wanted to do it. None of the other selectmen even wanted to do a show. Well, when he lost the election, he was no longer a Southwick selectman. So I let him cool off a little bit because I knew that was needed.
Yeah.
And then said, you become a good interviewer and you have a good... You can still represent your town just as a host now, not as a politician.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And he still does a show to this day.
Yeah, and I feel the same way. It's like, you know what? I didn't want to have to give this up. It was something that I loved from the very beginning when we were at the college still. And the first time I ever came on Tina's show back, I don't even know how many years ago that was.
That was quite a while.
And it's contagious. And, you know, you just get – and you love coming in here. You love the, you know, the other people that you run into, whether they're your guests or other people that have shows or Pete. You know, these are great people. And so I decided I'm going to stick around. And we'll see what's to come. I imagine it'll be more of like what we did today. And we'll just keep adding until something sticks and we'll have more guests. I didn't want a guest today because, like I said, I didn't know if it was going to be the last or not. So thank you, Pete, for talking me off the ledge. And
I would say the same to anybody because that's what this is truly all about.
Right, right. Yeah, and I don't care how many views I get. You know what I can do? I can keep watching the same video 75 times.
You can also promote it.
Well, that's another thing. Start
sharing the video.
Yes. Oh, I know. I gotta.
Like or, Kenny does.
I'd like an intro like Tina has. You know, a little commercial, right?
Oh, a cross promo.
Yeah.
Yeah, we could do that.
All right. Both of us. And,
yeah. Whatever. Okay.
Well, it's 9 o'clock. I'm happy to be here. I'm happy to be staying here. I hope you have enjoyed this last hour. We'll strive to make it better and better every month. And thank you for listening, and stay happy, my friends.
Bye-bye.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family.